It was once believed that radical intermediates were too unstable to be useful for selective organic chemical reactions. The argument ran that even if one could generate an organic radical, it would be too short-lived and reactive to perform any useful chemistry. Although we now know this argument to be flawed, the fact remains that generating a stoichiometric amount of an unstable radical intermediate is essentially impossible. A mechanism like the one you see here, in which two substrates combine to form a radical intermediate which goes on to form products, is too simple to account for experimental observations of the reactivity of radicals. And yet, how is it that full equivalents of S1 and S2 can be transformed to products without the essentially stoichiometric generation of radicals? The essential ingredient this simple mechanism is missing is a radical initiator, which is required for all radical reactions. Remarkably, however, a full equivalent of the initiator is not necessary. All we need is a small amount to set off a chain reaction that results in full conversion of the starting materials to products. This implies that the radical intermediates formed upon initiation must undergo a cyclic mechanism that regenerates the radical formed by initiation while also forming the products. These cyclic steps have been given a special name by organic chemists. They're called propagation steps, and they're the meat of radical chain mechanisms. Here's an overall generalized picture of a radical chain mechanism, or RCM. Every RCM has three general phases: initiation, in which the initiator reacts with a small amount of substrate to produce an organic radical; propagation, in which the products form and the aforementioned radical is regenerated; and termination, in which radicals combine with each other to form undesired even electron side products. Notice the electron counts written in parentheses under each species. All of the even electron species are stable starting materials or products, while the odd electron radical species are only found within the cyclic steps. In theory, an RCM requires only a single odd electron molecule to be present at any given time. Let's take a look at a specific example of a radical chain mechanism, peroxide-promoted hydrobromination of an alkene. We would expect, if a carbocation were involved in the mechanism, that the bromine would end up at the secondary rather than the primary position. However, when a small amount of a radical initiator is used in conjunction with HBr, the opposite selectivity is observed. The bromine ends up exclusively on the primary position. Because the peroxide is essential, you might expect it to get involved in the mechanism early, and you're exactly right. The first step of initiation is homolytic cleavage of the OO bond. The resulting alkoxy radical then reacts with HBr to produce a bromine radical. There's a very good reason to expect HBr to get involved before the hydrocarbon. The small size and relatively low BDE of HBr suggests that it is more reactive towards the alkoxy radical than the hydrocarbon. A little bit later on, when we reach the end of the propagation steps, we'll again justify generating Br dot at this stage. Notice that the BDE of the starting material, HBr, is less than the BDE of the product alcohol. This tells us that the hydrogen atom abstraction step is thermodynamically favorable. With Br dot in hand, it now makes sense to get the alkene involved. Now that the other substrate has entered the fray, we've left the initiation phase and are beginning the propagation phase. During propagation steps, even electron species, the starting materials, react with the odd electron radical intermediates, leading to new even electron compounds, which are the products, and regenerated radical. We've already seen that radicals can interact with pi bonds to create a single bond and a new radical. However, when an asymmetrically substituted pi bond is used, two additions are possible. The bromine may end up attached to the inner, secondary carbon, or the outer, primary carbon. Based on what we've learned about radical stability trends, this should be an easy choice. The radical prefers to be stationed on the more substituted secondary position. We need to quench this radical intermediate with an H atom to produce the observed product. While we could, in theory, grab it from the alcohol produced during initiation, it makes much more sense to pick an H off of HBr, which has a lower bond dissociation energy and is present in much larger concentration than the alcohol HOR. Notice that this H to sigma star interaction accomplishes both of the goals of propagation. The product is formed and the propagating radical, Br dot, has been regenerated. The regenerated radical goes on to react with another molecule of alkene, and its regeneration continues until all of the HBr present has been exhausted. In the next webcast, we'll discuss termination steps, which can throw a wrench in the works of radical chain mechanisms.